Hello, this is the Diplomatic Encounter, current affairs program where we go beyond the general headlines, giving you fresh new perspective. Today, Gibson Nyikadzino discusses the relationship between Zimbabwe and South Sudan with His Excellency Gabriel G. Riak, who is the head of mission of South Sudan in Zimbabwe.
Today in the studio, I'm joined by the head of mission of the Republic of South Sudan here in Zimbabwe, Ambassador Gabriel Guy Riak. Today we're going to discuss quite a number of issues. As you are aware, the country had a euphoria when it got its independence, but today things are different. Ambassador, welcome to the program.
You're most welcome also.
I would want to begin with the relations between Zimbabwe and the Republic of South Sudan. How do you view them?
The relations between Zimbabwe and South Sudan are warm and cordial.
Can you mention, when you're saying they are warm and cordial, how really are you putting it?
Well, they could be backdated to the time when the South Sudanese were having the liberation war up to the 90s, when the bilateral relations with Zimbabwe started during the time of our late chairman and commander-in-chief, Dr. John Garang Damavir.
So in short, you are saying Zimbabwe has been a partner in supporting the cause of the people of South Sudan during the period when you were fighting from 1983?
Absolutely.
And what lessons have you learned from Zimbabwe?
We have learned the lessons of being Africans together. We've been supporting the cause of South Sudan, like some of the other African countries. But we have the best lesson when we had our representative here for 18 years, who is now our present Minister of Foreign Affairs, Dr. Barnaba Maria Benjamin.
Then, Zimbabwe has been helping the people of South Sudan by having delegates coming from
Absolutely.
South Sudan.
Yeah, we were passing here, especially our delegations when they were going to Southern Africa or to West Africa for negotiations with the government of the whole Sudan. So some of the people were passing here, some were coming here to get the advice from Comrade Mugabe and many other leaders of Africa who were for the cause of South Sudan by then.
The country, it got its independence, let me say, close to 5 years ago, but now the situation is fragile. Are the countries still supporting you in that state?
Well, they are morally with us and politically with us. Although the coup of former vice president destabilized the situation, political situation in the country, still the people of Zimbabwe are with us morally. Yeah.
But the people, generally the South Sudanese, how are they seeing the situation on the ground? Because the country is not yet built on a solid foundation because of civil strife. How is the situation detrimental to them?
Well, the situation has gone back almost to 60%. It has demoralized our people because the war was not intended for the common man. It was a power struggle between the first vice president and the president, in which that should have not been extended by the vice president to kill even the masses and destroy most of the infrastructures.
But the social structure, and How are people going to be helped? Clinics working, hospitals working, and other government departments, are they fully functional
to save the interest of the people? They were destroyed by the rebel groups by the time, where even they were killing people in the hospitals, the patients were killing people in the churches. So most of the social fabric or infrastructure, up to now they have not yet been rebuilt because the war is undergoing very bad economic situation.
Besides getting moral support from Zimbabwe and other governments, what is the international community doing in order to save the situation on the ground?
Well, the international community is trying to bring the two parties together to resolve the problem. But it seems there is something lacking. There is no seriousness on the rebel group or the rebel leader, and he is not being given pressure by the international community.
So that he can come to the negotiating table?
Absolutely. He has already come, but the agreement which was signed on the basis of the countries or those international communities supporting the rebel. So the agreement was framed according to the liking of the former vice president.
Viewers, we are talking to the head of mission of the Republic of South Sudan here in Zimbabwe, Ambassador Gabriel Guy Riak. Just for a short break, we'll be right back. Stay tuned. Welcome back, viewers. This is the second segment of the Diplomatic Encounter. Today we are talking to the head of mission of the Republic of South Sudan in Zimbabwe, Ambassador Gabriel Guy Riak. Your Excellence, December 15, 2013 was a very bad day for the people of South Sudan when the president fired the first vice president, who was instigating the rebellion according to the government.
Well, initially the rebellion was on the 15th of December, but he was fired in July by the president because he was criticizing the government. He was the first vice president. And that was looking like shooting your foot with your own either gun or a spear.
But it was not the second time the former vice president had that rebellion. In 1991, I understand, he had another rebellion. What was the disturbance to the unit of the people, these rebellions?
Well, it was very demoralizing when he made under three coup in 1991 in a place called Nasser. And that was the time when our refugees were even in Ethiopia. So they had to track back to the liberated areas of South Sudan. And during that coup, he killed a lot of some of the SPLA who were supporters of the mainstream. He killed a good number of people, over even 1,000.
Who are really supporting him? Who are supporting him since 1991? You then organized yourselves, incorporated him. In 2013, he did the same thing. Who are supporting him?
Well, we don't have very substantial evidences, but there are people. There are people with him internationally. Some countries who are not happy with the government of South Sudan being strong. They want a soft target or a person who is a yes man to give them the contracts of our oil. These are the people with them.
According to other scholars, they are saying the government, the present government, it gave oil contracts to the Chinese, and the former vice president promised the Western handlers, according to these scholars, Western handlers, that when I get into power, I would reverse all the contracts that were given to the Chinese. I'll give them to you. How far true is that?
Well, to the best of my knowledge, or being an insider by then and up to now, all the contracts of oil were not given to the Chinese. There were some blocks. We were reserved for those countries which had the interest to come and do the business of oil. But these people became impatient. That is why they went for him, or for the former vice president, so that he can speed up by giving them those blocks of oil.
And now oil is the main source of revenue for the government, but the international prices, they have gone down.
And that has brought it to a very bad stage.
And how, again, is the government trying to sustain the livelihoods of people? Which other sectors, economic sectors?
People, I think lately our government has resorted to the sector, agricultural sector, which was neglected when we came from the bush. And that, I think, in the next 1 or 2 years, people will be investing in agriculture.
Besides agriculture, the mining sector, are there other minerals, other precious gems besides oil, which the country can tap in order to draw economic value?
Well, South Sudan is rich of many things, being minerals, which have not yet been exploited. But they are there. It was just a matter to have a time, and all these areas should have been extended to be of benefit to the South Sudanese.
But of exchange programs that have happened between the government of South Sudan and the government of Zimbabwe, do you have any Zimbabwean explorers, investors who are willing to put their money in the government of South Sudan or in South Sudan?
The war of 21 months brought everything to stand still, even if there were good Zimbabweans who wanted to go and invest in South Sudan. They have cut back their investment. They are waiting for the peace to come back.
Your Excellency, there are reports that have come out. The most recent one by the Human Rights Watch, it says the soldiers, government soldiers, last October 2015, they suffocated 60 people, men and young boys. They put them in a container, and they shut the container and they suffocated, they died, because they were accused of supporting the rebel movement of the former vice president. What's your response to those allegations?
In accordance with the response to that allegation, I think even when we were fighting the people in the old Sudan who were the Arabs, we were not doing that. Not being our South Sudanese, that has been an allegation fabricated somewhere, but it's not what the government soldiers have done, to my best knowledge.
Viewers, just keep holding. We are coming with the third and final segment just after this short break. Welcome back, viewers, to our third and final segment. Today in the studio, I'm joined by the head of mission of the Republic of South Sudan here in Zimbabwe, Ambassador Gabriel Guy Riak. Your Excellence, as a continuation, you are saying the international media is giving some information to the people. What do you think is their role in this escalating conflict? Are they playing it fair? Are they giving people what is happening on the ground?
Well, to my own assessment, that is my personal view, the media is not giving the right information to our people, especially if it is on the side of the rebels. But the government is giving the right information, as I am a part of that government.
Then I would want to look at another issue, the difficulties we are facing today. Do you see a future where there will be peace in South Sudan?
Yeah, with the difficulties we are facing, they do not come from thy own. They were created by the rebellion of the last 21 months. But our hopes are that everything has gotten in. We have been fighting for over 50 years in order to become an independent country. But at the end, we have achieved it at last. So there is a high hope that we will one time become a peaceful country.
And I understand in molding the peace, there have been steps that have been made by a government, engaging the government of Zimbabwe, where there's an issue of scholarships, students from South Sudan coming. What is the development so far?
The big steps have been taken by the government of Zimbabwe to accept our 200 students to have scholarships here, and the memorandum of understanding was signed last January, on the 5th of January, by the two principals, that is Professor Maya and Dr. John Guy here in Harare.
Suppose we have a peaceful future in South Sudan, like how you are putting it, that you have been fighting for a long time and you are seeing a good South Sudan in the future. The African Union, you were the last member to join the 54-member bloc. The African Union, how has it been helping South Sudan achieve the peace which we really want to see in Africa?
I think the African Union has been of helpful, or has been of good use, but the IGAD took over the initiative to be the one handling the case. And we are not happy with the IGAD role. IGAD role seemed to have been on the side of the rebel leader, especially. If it was entirely left to the AU, I think we would have got something in the shortest possible time, a solution. We would have been durable.
So are you saying the IGAD, it is not executing the peace process fairly?
To my own observation, it has been one-sided.
Then perhaps...
And because of being one-sided, there were some international countries, especially the foreign countries, which were giving a push to the way things should be done by the IGAD.
It seems there is a foreign hand that is directing...
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah.
But it's a sad note, especially for Africa. But commenting on that, what do you think is the role of the elderly in Africa? For example, we have former AU chair, President Robert Mugabe. He has been regarded as a greatest African statesman by members in the continent. How do you see his political vision, his ideology, and also his wish for South Sudan and for Africa as a whole in settling this issue?
Well, if the AU had taken over fully. And especially at the time when Comrade Mugabe was the chair of the AU, I think a better solution would have been found than to be handled by the IGAD.
What's your message to Zimbabweans who are listening today?
My message to the Zimbabwean people is that in crisis, like what is happening now, especially the economic crisis, let them remain resilient. And I don't want them to copy what happened in South Sudan with our former vice president by taking arms and given 98 steps backward. So let them be resilient and approach the issues by talking.
Your Excellency, thank you for joining us to this
podcast. You are most welcome.
We hope you enjoyed that discussion between Gibson Nyikadzino and the head of mission of South Sudan in Zimbabwe. If you want more information, please contact us on the details that are showing on the screen below, and feel free to join our social media networking on YouTube, WhatsApp, and Facebook. Until then, goodbye.